originator of the death of the modern death metal scene from Florida would have to be Death.
When we started out as late 83, and there's no scene, you know, people didn't even know what death metal was and thrash metal in general. And, you know, it's very difficult to be playing that type of stuff back then.
Well, a lot of the players from the hardcore bands started hearing, you know, heavier stuff, basically. And then they decided to go branch out and start to, you know, develop a style of music of their own. And that's where the Death Kids started doing it, you know. And I think it was just a logical kind of, you know, progression from it.
We stuck it out and, you know, little by little, I could see the, you know, scene progressing, definitely. And I think a lot of people have been proven wrong in general about thrash.
It's kind of weird that it's just this particular area that in Florida that's got the majority of death metal bands that are kind of famous in the world.
What we have here is off limits. This is basically kiddie land. Nobody's here.
Venues have always been a problem, you know, they've always been a problem. We've always had problems with venues, you know, authorities getting down on us.
Right.
Bar owners don't know, understand the kids. The police don't understand, you know, the way that they, you know, go out and enjoy themselves, especially when they mosh and they, you know, get a slam pit going.
Non-alcoholic, all ages, like kiddie land, basically.
The first time for us with no alcohol, because I usually have beer on stage, so this would be the first time with no beer on stage. So it'll be interesting.
And we've been told they've heard of us and they understand what we do and not to do it here. No dirty words, no violence. And we've been told they have a security guard who knows what moshing looks like. And if it's not proper, they're going to stop the show. We've been warned.
The club scene in Tampa is actually pretty piss poor. There was one place, the Sunset, where a lot of the bands got their start and played at. And that's closed down. And basically now, there's a couple, like the Rocker Club, a couple places that are just like play regular metal. That'll have like a thrash night or a, you know, death night. But it'll be like on a Monday or something. And you basically have to pay to play. And
this is Paul. He's the main man here at the club. This is Todd, band to play tonight. He's from Power Surge. There he is, the lead singer of World War III. Mike from Boomerangs, Junior from 98 Rock. And this is Jenny.
The pit bitch.
Come on. Here's Vinny from World War III.
There's a growing trend now for major national bands to bring in two support bands with them, which kind of restricts the local bands from playing.
Over a period of time, you know, there was only one place left. That was the Sunset Club, where, I mean, all of us used to play Savage, us, you know, Oblivion, Obituary back when they were Executioner. And then that place got shut down because of shitty management, you know, and I think the Metalhead kids pretty much destroyed the bar, so it was, you couldn't use the place for anything else. Right now, there is no place for the metal kids to go and hang out. And this is where we practice.
Walking in the subway.
place is, I think, it's pretty famous, actually, especially to the Europeans, because it's a little warehouse center where some of the best bands from Florida practice right here. You know, there's like 26 bands in this complex, but, you know, Nocturnus, Morbid Angel, Power Surge, us. Shit, man, there's Roadkill practices right next door to us. There's a lot of bands that, you know, are in this whole little deal here.
Well, nobody else is here because nobody practices at fucking 12:30 in the afternoon. But, like, you can tell the real serious bands from the real fucking wannabes, because on Friday nights, it's like us and three other bands that are out here practicing. Everybody else has to go out and get some beers and shit, and we do that maybe after practice or something. But now throughout the rest of the week, there's usually fucking so many bands here you can hardly drive through the place.
Obituary was maybe one of the first to actually come out of our studio, but there were a lot of bands in the area that were at the same time. I'm not sure it's fair to say that Obituary started it. It all seemed to happen almost at the same time. It's like something like a pot that's ready to boil, and once it goes all at once, and that's kind of the way that I see what happened here. Well, the success, I think, of some of the albums, particularly that Scott has done, but some also that myself and my brother Jim have worked on, got a lot of recognition, and we've had a lot of bands coming from New York and California and Texas and the UK and Germany to come and record with us, and that's great. We love that, and we love having a reputation that allows us to do that.
Well, it's the death metal capital of the world, isn't it?
Yeah, you just go.
Get the results.
You go wherever's best. I mean, it doesn't matter if there's 10,000 bands been there before, or one, or none. You just go wherever's the best.
The point is, I mean, I know a lot of bands are probably thinking now, I know it's happened, that bands have started to think, oh, well, let's not go to Morrisound because everybody else is doing it. But that's not the main issue for us, where we're concerned. The issue is that Morrisound continually comes up with good albums. We're in the right environment to record now, with Scott Burns in the studio he always works in. It's going to be so much easier from the production and engineering point that we can just really sit back and let Scott take care of the whole of that, and we can really concentrate on just recording a good album.
People in the press have said about me, isn't it trendy to use Scott Burns now because, like, say, Death has used me or Obituary has used me. And, you know, that may very well be a true statement. But the only defense I can offer is, you know, there's nobody else in this genre that listens to underground music that does that likes heavy music that I know of as a producer or engineer or whatever you want to call me. Also, there's probably nobody that can do an album, or not very few people, I shouldn't say anybody, that can do an album for $5,000 or $10,000. I'm definitely a fan, I mean, you know, but I would say I'm probably more of a fan of extreme music than just death metal in general. I mean, I probably got into death metal late, probably not until 85, 86, after, like, Venom and Possessed and all them. But like I said, I've always liked anything from the Sex Pistols when they came out. I thought they were probably, you know, it was great just to stand up there and spit on somebody and, you know, I don't know. But anyway, that's another story.
At the time we went there, not many bands had gone there. Mm. And like now it's like totally overkill, you know, we've got to go and use Scott Burns and all that. And like, it was good for us because like...
We went for the clarity sort of
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, that album to me just proves to people that we weren't just the noise.
It's not fair for Scott because a lot of people just look at Scott and Morrisound as like the new in death metal thing, right? But fucking Scott's into the music. I've known him for like a long time. I recorded with him before with another band. And it's unfair when they say, like, oh, he's like the trendy producer for death metal or whatever.
I mean, he's totally into the music.
He's into the music. He produces bands he likes.
I guess if the band decides that they wanted to spend $85,000, then that was their decision, and that's great. But at the same time, I mean, I think if the record label's telling you to spend $85,000 because you're going to sell X amount of more records, I think that's a load of shit. Because I think, you know, that a lot of $5,000 albums, you know, Obituary, the first album, was done for $3,000. And it's probably sold 50, 60,000 copies. Maybe not that many. At least 40, I've been told, you know. And I mean, you know, I think, you know, that's not what the music's all about. It's not about slick production or anything like that. It's not like listening to a Madonna record. I mean, kids like it because it's extreme, because it's brutal, because it's heavy, because whatever. Seems like the labels always make money, but the bands rarely do.
We were called Executioner before we were called Obituary. Changed our name because, you know, we had to because of a Boston Executioner. And, you know, it was a sudden change for us to change our name because we were Executioner for, you know, 5 out of the 6 years we were Executioner. And then now, right before Slowly Rot came out, we had to change our name for that, you know, before our first album was released.
What happened is that I'm not playing in Obituary anymore, and luckily this time, you know, this is one departure from a band. It's definitely a real, you know, friendly situation. You know, I'm still really good friends with the guys in the band, and we still get along. But it was, what happened was that when I joined the band, the former guitar player, Alan, who was a founding member of the band, and original writer of the band, he had to leave for personal reasons, and once he got them resolved, it was always understood that that my position might be temporary.
I'm very pleased with this album. I mean, with Slowly Rot, I think we had to be pleased because that's all we could work with the budget, with the equipment we had, and, you know, with the experience we had. Now, with Cause of Death, the music itself, you know, not just the production, but the music, the songs, were definitely, we were more mature as a musician, as songwriters. We were definitely better songwriters than on the Slowly album, I think.
The lyrics definitely vary. Some bands, there are no lyrics, or very little lyrics, say, like Obituary. I mean, John, I don't think he ever planned it. One day we were just sitting around and we were gonna write down lyrics, and we, you know, came up with it that there really wasn't any lyrics, that there's a few lines here and there. And like I said, I don't think it's anything John ever planned. It's just his style. But I mean, I've seen them practice 100 times, and he'll always sing the same thing twice, you know. I think the funniest thing is he'll tell me after a show, or some kid will come up and say, you know, yeah, I was singing along to Cause of Death. And he'll ask him, oh, are you singing? I don't even know what I was singing.
Aces Records has been in Oldsmar for 5 years now. We started up in New Jersey about 10 years ago, and we've really built a heavy metal business here. There really wasn't any heavy metal here, and we've really grown from a small booth to a 2,000 square foot store. And we've got people like James Murphy from Obituary who works here, David Vincent from Morbid Angel. A lot of the local death bands come in here regularly. I think a lot of the kids that started with the traditional heavy metal and got into the death metal can't go back, because there's so much energy in the death metal that anything less than that is just boring.
It's a tough thing to find the right people, and unfortunately, things happen in life that affects, you know, being in a band with people. You know, it always doesn't work out, and you know, I was with Bill and Terry for quite a while, and we were definitely more than just band members. We were best friends. So that's also another factor that's really drag when you lose members. Sometimes friendship is involved, and that I think is the main issue, in my opinion.
We can't tolerate inconsistency, because, you know, other tours were canceled. You know, we were willing to do those tours, and for other, various reasons, Chuck wouldn't, you know, go over to Europe and tour. So this time we were determined to go, no matter what.
You know, death touring, and I'm in Florida, is just a really incredible concept, you know, in general. and you know, it depressed me at certain times, and I tried to get over there at one point, and it's just not a very good situation. There's a lot of you know, bad things going on out there as far as, you know, feelings towards me in general, and so, you know, I didn't make it out there, unfortunately. I wanted to, but never did.
We were left with no choice but to fulfill the obligations of the contracts we had, you know. And
one thing that Chuck doesn't realize, see, at this moment, he thinks that, you know, we were all good friends. He thinks me and Terry turned our back on him, yeah, and went over there with Al when he was having problems.
There's a lot of emotional stuff involved. It's a real drag. You know, people just look at me being a jerk, obviously, I guess, in their eyes, because I, you know, have problems with lineups. But, you know, I don't understand that. Just because I have problems doesn't mean I'm hard to get along with.
But right now, me and Bill are going to put out this Massacre album with the original members. We're supposed to record the album in 3 weeks. It'll be out in mid-year.
Are you going to become permanent members of Massacre?
At this moment right now, I'm not sure, but we're going to do this album for sure.
Just
though.
For sure this, yeah, album, you know, just, I've always wanted to put, see, when I had Massacre going in 84, 85, there was, you know, none of these bands, the DSI, none of that stuff, you know, and we couldn't get a record deal. We tried, and now, you know, when I got in Death, all these bands came out and got deals.
Instantly.
So sure. I just want to put this record out. All the old material will be real simple, but it'll be brutal.
Sure, I guess there's competition on the market, but, you know, I feel very positive about the material I put out. I think it, you know, stands on its own, and people know a Death record when they put it on. Well, at the moment, you know, I'm working on new material, got half the record down right now. I got friends of mine from the band Cynic. You know, the drummer Sean and guitar player Paul are helping me out, rehearsing. They're, you know, gonna help me out in the studio, and so it's really great. You know, it's good to know I still have friends.
Cynic approximately formed in November of 87. I guess we didn't actually become serious till the middle or end of 89, or throughout 89 actually, when we released our first official demo, Reflections. And then, you know, we kept, I guess, challenging ourselves musically and finding more creative direction and more input and everything, you know, our whole self-evaluation improved throughout the years, and we finally ended up with this lineup. We released the 90 demo in 90, and I guess till now, which we're intending to hopefully release an album by, which would probably hopefully be out by the beginning of 92, we're figuring.
Florida is not like an attendance place as far as like playing wise. I haven't seen massive halls, or like whenever we play out of town, the attendance is usually double that and much more enthusiastic than it is down here, which kind of like makes me wonder what the Florida scene is.
Hi, my name is Evil Don. I'm the singer for Mortuary, and things are going pretty good with the band so far. We just finished our first demo. Hopefully we'll get it somewhere. The guy with the tie-dye, Mike, and I'm going to hand the mic to Mike.
Mortuary is about being brutal. We want to see bodies fly, bodies slamming, blood, puke, piss, you name it, we want it.
A band coming out of here, I think, has a better chance just because they're from here. You know, it's like, it's known everywhere. You know, Tampa for heavy music is like LA is for, like, fag music, you know? It just, people look here, man. It's like, got Death, Obituary, Atheist, Deicide, man. Morbid Angel, you know, it's just, the area's hot, man. It's just, the clubs haven't got it yet, you know?
Yeah, the fans are generally mostly musicians, the people that are in bands.
Unless it's all ages. Yeah, if it's all ages, you get quite a bit of a crowd.
Yeah, the club scene, you know, the 18 and over, 21 and over, you know, is is a little bit lacking as far as the number of people, you know.
We are Thrash! Yeah. Tampa, Florida, and we need a bass player!
All y'all motherfucking thrashing people come out here and jump!
There's a lot of competition, attitude-wise, like, you know, everyone, as you know what the neat thing is, as soon as a band comes out the record these days, they're bigger than Metallica or whatever in their eyes. And it's a long fucking battle and just struggle to get to the top of that ladder, you know, the music deal.
I think that, I think it's getting really big, in terms of overrated, no, because there's a lot of good talent here. I think that the talent that's here is making it, and then there's like an entity that's trying to exploit the talent and make something somewhat of it's really becoming a trend. But I think the good bands that are good bands are going to survive, and the rest is just going to move on like they always do.
We all get along pretty well.
Yeah, I mean, there's a few things here that I think a lot of magazines and interviews that they try and eat at the false parts or the parts that you will. If someone says something about us, that's, you know, they say this little bit, that magazine's gonna break it up and make it this big, and it'll cause a controversy through the bands. But when we're all together and we play shows together, everyone's basically friends, you know.
I don't know if the music can get too much more extreme.
People don't give a fuck, you know. It's being accepted, and being that extremity is almost common now.
I don't know whether all the bands really always want to play fast. When we talk to them, they all say, well, anybody can play fast, but it doesn't mean we play better.
Every band has their own identity.
It shouldn't stay underground or only as big as it is now. I hope that it will get big, because it should. I would love to see it. I think that in the 1990s, that I think it will definitely grow more than it has been in the past 5 years, 10 years.